الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأصلي وأسلم على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، نبينا وحبيبنا وقرة أعيننا محمد بن عبد الله، عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. وقال تعالى في كتابه العزيز بعد: أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: وقضى ربك ألا تعبدوا إلا إياه وبالوالدين إحسانا إما يبلغن عندك الكبر أحدهما أو كلاهما فلا تقل لهما أف ولا تنهرهما وقل لهما قولا كريما، واخفض لهما جناح الذل من الرحمة، وقل رب ارحمهما كما ربياني صغيرا. ربكم أعلم بما في نفوسكم، إذ تكونوا صالحين فإنه كان للأوابين غفورا. As always, we begin by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is our creator, sustainer, nourisher, protector, and curer. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to shower His choicest of blessings and salutations upon our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his family members, his companions, and all those who tread upon his path with utmost sincerity until the day of Qiyamah. O children of Adam, first and foremost, I enjoin upon myself and then all of you all who have come here to adopt a life of taqwa. For taqwa, which is the fear and the consciousness of Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is the ultimate goal behind Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala creating all of us and all of these things that we witness in the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is the ultimate goal. Allah the Almighty Himself says in the Noble Quran, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. Allah the Maker, He says that I have not created jinnkind or mankind for any other purpose other than ibadah, other than the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And He Himself says in another place, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ اعْبُدُوا رَبَّكُمُ الَّذِي خَلَقَكُمْ وَالَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. O mankind, worship your Lord who created you and created those before you, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ, so that you'll become people of taqwa, so that you'll bring in taqwa. The purpose behind Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala creating us is worship, ibadah. And the ultimate purpose behind ibadah, behind worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is that we become people of taqwa. So it is upon us, the slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to adopt a life of taqwa, to bring in taqwa into our lives, to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to be conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if we wish to attain success in this world as well as the hereafter. May Allah the Almighty make us all from the people of taqwa, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us successful in this world as well as the hereafter. To proceed, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, inshallah ta'ala, the topic for today's khutbah is my beloved mother and my beloved father. Inshallah ta'ala, the khutbah will evolve around an individual's rights towards his parents. It will, inshallah ta'ala, evolve around how important it is for an individual to be good to his parents. For if not, if it is the opposite of that, if we treat our parents bad, and that is known as a uququl walidain, which we will discuss as we go, Allah save us all, we become part of an evil sign of the day of Qiyamah. An evil sign of the day of Qiyamah. May Allah save us all. This is taught to us by our beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in an extremely famous hadith, which has been recorded by Imam al-Bukhari, by Imam Muslim, by Imam Ahmad, Imam Tirmidhi, Imam Ibn Majah, Imam Ibn Hibban, and also it has been recorded in many other books of ahadith. But for today's khutbah, inshallah ta'ala, we will stick to the narration of Imam Muslim, rahimahullah. Qala Muslim, rahimahullah. Imam Muslim, rahimahullah, he says, حدثني أبو الخيثمة زهير بن حرب حدثنا وكيع عن كهمس عن عبد الله بن بريدة عن يحيى بن يعمر قال. He says that Abu al-Khaythama, Zuhair ibn Harb, says that Waqi', he narrates from Waqi', from Kahmas. These are all the narrators of the hadith. All of them go on to say, finally Yahya ibn Ya'mar, he says that in regard to the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in regard to the destiny of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the divine decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the first person to talk about it, in other words, to negate the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to deny the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he was Ma'bad al-Juhani. So this person who is narrating the hadith, فانطلقت أنا وحميد بن عبد الرحمن الحميري حاجين أو معتمرين. The person who is narrating the hadith, he is saying that me and my companion, both of us, we went as pilgrims, either for Hajj or for Umrah. We went as pilgrims. We set out from where we were, and the narration goes on to the effect that they say that we decided that the minute we set out, the first Sahabi radiallahu anhu we meet, we will discuss about this, we will put this issue forward to him in regard to the people who were denying the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now what happened? They set out and the first person they saw entering the masjid was Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu. It was Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu. So these two companions, they rushed to Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu. One of them took to his right side and the other to his left side, and they wanted to converse with him. Oh, Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu. And they put forward this issue. They said that from our people, now there are people coming up, they're saying that they deny the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They're talking about the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the divine decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In regard to all of this, Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, very sternly he says, inform those people, along the lines of these words, inform those people that I, Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu, I am free of them and that they are free of me. I do not want to have anything to do with them. I do not want to have anything to do with them if they deny the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the divine decree of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he goes on to say, for I have heard my father, Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, saying. And now the hadith begins. In other words, the hadith that we hear often. He says, بينما نحن جلوس عند رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ذات يوم. That on one fine day, Umar radiallahu anhu is now narrating the narration. One fine day we were seated with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. اطلع علينا رجل شديد بياض الثياب. Suddenly a man emerges, a man approaches our gathering, a man wearing a sparkling white dress. شديد سواد الشعر. He was having jet black hair. لا يرى عليه أثر السفر. None of us could see any signs of journey upon him. No fatigue, no tiredness.
لا يرى عليه أثر السفر ولا يعرفه منا أحد. And none of us knew him. My dear respected elders, brothers in Islam, this hadith is so vivid. It is so detailed. We can keep on discussing and bringing out masail from the narration. It is such a beautiful narration. But the point that I wish to highlight is not in these parts, so we will move swiftly. He says that a man appeared wearing a sparkling white dress, jet black hair, no signs of fatigue or journey were visible on him. He goes straight to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and sits by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In what manner the Sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhi majma'in was so observant. They were the best of students. He describes exactly how this man went and sat by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. His knees were touching the knees of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he placed his hands on his thighs, exactly how a student must sit in front of his teacher. Allahu Akbar. And now what happens? He says, Ya Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, akhbirni anil Islam. He says, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, tell me about Islam. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam teaches him what is Islam. أن تشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأن محمد رسول الله. It is to bear witness that there is no God but Allah سبحانه وتعالى. And then he goes on mentioning the articles of, in other words, Islam, the pillars of Islam. And then he goes on to ask him, فأخبرني عن الإيمان. Tell me about إيمان. And Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم teaches him what is إيمان. أن تؤمن بالله وملائكته وكتبه, until the end of that part. He teaches him the articles of faith, to believe in Allah, to believe in his angels, to believe in his books, and so on. And then he asks Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and now we are coming to the part that I wish to highlight. فَأَخْبِرْنِي عَنِ السَّاعَةِ. Tell me about the last day or the last hour. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replies, مَا الْمَسْؤُولُ عَنْهَا بِأَعْلَمَ مِنَ السَّائِلِ. That the one who is being questioned, look at the eloquent reply of our master sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The one who is being questioned knows no better than the questioner. Because now Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had identified who this individual was. It was none other than Jibreel alayhi salatu wa salam, who had come in the guise of a human being to teach the sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhi majma'in, to teach the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam their deen. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, the one who is questioned knows no better than the questioner. And then the man, in other words, Jibreel alayhi salatu wa salam, now asks Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, فَأَخْبِرْنِي عَنْ أَمَارَاتِهَا. If that is the case, then inform me of the signs of the day of Qiyamah. Inform me of the signs of the last hour. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, أَنْ تَلِدَ الْأَمَةُ رَبَّتَهَا. In another riwayah, رَبَّهَا. This is one of the signs of the day of Qiyamah, which was taught to us by our master sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. أَنْ تَلِدَ الْأَمَةُ رَبَّتَهَا. The translation, the direct translation for that would be, is that a slave girl would give birth to her mistress, or in another narration, to her master. A slave girl would give birth to her mistress, or in another narration, her master. Now the scholars, rahimahumullah, they have brought in so many explanations for this one statement of our master sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I will mention a few and then move on to the most beautiful explanation, which has been given to us by Imam Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani rahimahullah. Well, some of the scholars say that it could be that a man would own a slave girl. A man would own a slave girl. This is when the laws of slavery are applicable. He would own a slave girl. He would marry her. He would marry the slave girl. He would marry the slave girl. And he would, that slave girl would bear him a child, either a daughter or a son. And what would happen after bearing him a child? Now that child belongs to the master. belongs to the man of the house. He now sells that slave girl to somebody else. And by the time this boy or this girl grows up and becomes an adult, say it is a son, it is a boy, now he becomes a grown-up man, this slave girl, who is his mother, was now sold to the market. She goes all over, hand to hand, and then eventually comes back to him after he has grown up, say after 15 years or 20 years. And he purchases that slave girl, not knowing that she was his mother. That she was his mother. This is one of the explanations. But now that today we have slavery has been abrogated from the face of this earth, the explanation of Imam Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani rahimahullah fits in beautifully and gives us deep insight into this beautiful statement of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imam Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani rahimahullah, he says that this statement of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam indicates that towards the latter stages, when it is close to the day of Qiyamah, what will happen is tables will turn. Tables will turn. Everything will go topsy-turvy. In other words, children will start treating their parents like slaves. Children will start treating their parents like slaves. They will start ordering their parents to do this and to do that. And when their parents want something from their children, they will not be ready to listen to their parents. This is the explanation of Imam Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani rahimahullah. He says that children will start treating their parents like slaves, ordering them around, not respecting them, not treating them good. And this is from the signs of the day of Qiyamah. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, do we not see this manifesting itself around us in today's times? Do we not see this happening in front of our eyes? Do we not see the youngsters not respecting their parents? It is upon the children to be good children, and it is upon the parents to be good parents. It is not upon the parents to use these contexts, these ayat, or these ahadith to their own benefit and be bad parents. No. Islam strikes a balance, a beautiful balance in the middle. Anyway, coming back to the ayah that I recited in the beginning, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, وَقَضَى رَبُّكَ أَلَّا تَعْبُدُوا إِلَّا إِيَّاهُ وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says in that ayah, and your Lord has decreed that you worship none other than Him. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decreed that we worship none other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah the Almighty has also decreed that we be dutiful unto our parents. If any one of them, if one of them or both of them attain old age, say not to them, uff. We are not supposed to say uff, the word. وَلَا تَقُلْ لَهُمَا uff. We are not supposed to use even the word uff. And this word has been used to show that no words of disrespect should be used unto our parents. وَلَا تَقُلْ لَهُمَا uff. وَلَا تَنْهَرْهُمَا. And do not shout at them. Do not ignore them. But address them in terms of honor. Or use good words of honor when you address your parents. And lower, وَخْفِضْ لَهُمَا جَنَاحَ الذُّلِّ مِنَ الرَّحْمَةِ. And lower unto them thy wings of submission and humility through mercy. Lower your wings of submission and humility through mercy unto your parents. And then say, وَقُلْ رَبِّ ارْحَمْهُمَا كَمَا رَبَّيَانِي صَغِيرًا. And say, Ya Allah, O my Lord, bestow on them your mercy as they did bring me up when I was young. Pray for them. Pray for your parents. The ayah that I recited in the beginning, this was the translation. There is a narration which is recorded by Ad-Daylami, who says that Husayn ibn Ali radiyallahu anhuma is reported to have said that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said, لَوَ عَلِمَ اللَّهُ شَيْئًا مِنَ الْعُقُوقِ أَدْنَى مِنْ أُفٍ لَحَرَّمَهُ. Had there been a word, had there been something even lesser than uff, even lesser than uff in disrespect towards one's parents, Allah the Almighty would have made that also haram. Allah the Almighty would have forbidden that too. The word uff here is used to show that even the most insignificant, even grunting, when our parents want us to do something, even to grunt at their faces is not allowed, according to the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Scholars of tafsir, such as Imam Mujahid rahimahullah, they say that if one's parents grow old, Allahu Akbar, when one's parents grow old and they start urinating on themselves, they start passing stool on themselves, they have grown so old that they do not have control of their bladder, they do not have control of what is going on around them, they start doing all of this, do not ever feel disgusted. Do not ever turn your face away in disgust. And do not ever use the word uff, or do not ever say that you can't stand the sight of that. For why? Your parents used to do the same thing to you when you were young, when you were small, when you passed urine, when you passed stool, when you had no control of yourself, when you could not clean yourself up. They did it lovingly and caring for you. They did not do it out of disgust. They did not do it out of hate. No, rather they hugged you, they loved you, and they did it out of love. So likewise today, now your parents are old and they are doing the same thing that you did when you were young. Look after them carefully. Allahu Akbar. Our Salafun As-Salih, they say in regard to the place where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَخْفِضْ لَهُمَا جَنَاحَ الذُّلْ. Look at the words, profound words of our Maker. Lower unto your parents thy wings of submission and humility through mercy. Why is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala using the word wings? Our Salafun As-Salih, rahimahumullah, they say that the minute your parents, either your mom or your dad, your mother or your father calls you, do not go unto them walking, do not go unto them running, rather fly to them like how the birds fly. Allah says, وَخْفِضْ لَهُمَا جَنَاحَ الذُّلْ. Lower unto them thy wings. So when they call for you, rush, fly to them as fast as possible. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. Once a man goes to Umar radiallahu anhu, a man goes to Umar radiallahu anhu, and he informs Umar radiallahu anhu, Ya Umar, I have a mother who is old. She is so old that she cannot walk. So I carry her. I carry her. She cannot clean herself after she relieves herself. So I clean her. I do all of this. For her to relieve herself, I carry her perhaps to the fields or wherever, isolated, so that she can relieve herself. She can answer the call of nature in peace. And after she is done, I go by her, I turn away out of respect, and I clean her. I clean her after she has relieved herself. So have I fulfilled my haq unto her? Have I fulfilled my rights unto her? Umar radiallahu anhu says, no, you have not. You have not even fulfilled your haq towards your mother, for even one contraction she felt during her pregnancy. Allahu Akbar. Not even for one contraction. And he goes on to say, but anyway, what you are doing is good and persist in it. For why I said that was because now you are doing all of this for your parents or for your mother, waiting for her to expire, waiting for her to pass away from this world and relieve you of the burden you are in. But on the other hand, your mother did all of this for you, hoping that you will live a long life. Allah. Hoping that you will live a long life. Our parents, they did all of what they did. They cleaned us, they did this, they did that. All of us are seated here, you and I. It is because of what our parents sacrificed and did for us. Today people call me Sheikh Muiz Bukhari. People call me Sheikh. But I was Muiz Bukhari long time back. It was Allah's will and it was my parents' dua that I am what I am today. Allahu Akbar. It is upon us to be thankful to our parents. Today many of us, we don't look at our parents. We disregard our parents. We think of them as burdens. Some of us, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all, have dumped our parents in old age homes. Because we disregard them, we think of them as burdens. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, I swear by Allah, for the ones who have lost their parents, for the ones who have lost their parents, if it was possible for them to go and open up the graves of their parents, they would. All of us would do so. And we would take out our parents and hug them and kiss them. Because of the love we have for our parents. Before it's too late, mend things that have gone wrong with your parents. Shaykhul Islam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah, he says that if an individual has hurt his parents, if he has made his mother or his father cry, if he has made them shed tears because of him, it is upon him to go back to his parents and make them laugh. It is upon him to go back and make them smile. Allahu Akbar. How many of us have this chance that our parents are alive to do that? How many of us regret that we could not fulfill our parents' wishes? It is too late. How many of us have our parents with us right now? They are massive dose of Jannah. They are massive ways for us to achieve Jannah. Allahu Akbar. And remember, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, whatever goes around, comes around. There is an incident that has been narrated to us which took place in Saudi, in Riyadh. There was once a man who had an old mother and an old father. He was married and he had a son. His mother passed away and his father was left alone. So because his father was old, extremely old, no one to look after him, his father requested his son, "Can I come and live with you, oh my son?" His son was a well-off professional, earning a big salary, living in a big mansion, drivers, maids to their beck and call, beautiful wife, loving child, perfect life. His father asked him, "Oh my son, can I come and live with you because I am alone?" He agrees. Even though he does it not with a happy heart, because it is a duty upon him, he agrees and brings his father into his house. Now the father, he is an old man, and we know things that happen when you become old of age. He starts grumbling over every little thing, finding fault with every little thing. When it's hot, he goes and off the air condition, saying that it's cold for him. And he messes around when the food is laid, when he tries to eat, he eats like a baby and messes the table up, puts plates down, breaks things as an old man. Now, this young man's wife could not tolerate her father-in-law anymore. Why? Because she has her friends coming over and her father-in-law, who is an old man, keeps coming in front and disturbing and doing what not. So she goes to her husband and says, "You know what, this won't come right. We can't have your father in the house. It is either your father or me. So put your father out of the house." And this is what is happening today. Many of us, we tend to take our statements of our spouses over the statements of our parents. And it is wrong. It is condemned in our religion. We are not allowed to give preference to our spouses over our parents. Tomorrow any woman can be your wife, but no woman can be your mother. You can't just go to a woman on the street and say, "She is my mother." No one can replace our parents. So this man, he listens to what his wife said, and he goes to his father and says, "Oh my father, you know what, you have become a bigger burden now." So now they had some driver's quarters outside of their house, within the same compound, but outside the main house. It's like a servant's quarters. He said that, "I'm not putting you out of the house. You go and stay in the driver's quarters. You go and stay in the driver's quarters. The father, the old man, he's crying from inside. But he did not want to impose on his son. He did not want to become a bigger burden for his son. So he accepts, packs his things and moves to the driver's quarters. Allahu Akbar. Now what happens? They cut their relationship completely. The family with the father. They send the food through the maid to go and give the father. There's no relationship whatsoever. The old man is living in the driver's quarters. He does not come home at all. The food is just sent thrice through the maid. Allahu Akbar. Now each time what happens, this young girl, the man's wife, she sends food to her father-in-law in a plate, in a good plate. At times he breaks the plate because he's old. She gets sick and tired of the whole thing and she says, no more good crockery for him. I'm going to send the food in a plastic plate so that even if he drops it, there's no issue. It's not going to break. So for some time now the food is going back and forth in a plastic plate. And we know what happens to a plastic plate. It starts becoming old and stinky now. Now this is the relationship between the son and the father. Allahu Akbar, may Allah save us all. After some time, the maid now goes, after a few days, she goes to give food in that same dirty plastic plate. Oh, and in regard to his clothes, he used to be in that same old clothes for the whole week. And after 1 week, when he removes his clothes and keeps, the maid used to come and collect it and go and wash it and give it back to him. This was the relationship between the son and his father. Finally, after some days, one day the maid goes with the food to give the old father, she opens the door and he is sprawled on the ground, he has passed away. She screams, she cries out, oh, the old father has passed away. Everybody comes running. The wife, she comes running with a happy heart, finally, burden out of the way, he's passed away. The son comes running, oh, my father has passed away. He opens the door and the sight that greets him, he is disgusted. Because the clothes that were all heaped up in a corner are stinking. The food has dropped all over, nobody has cleansed the room. And his father is lying on the ground. He immediately calls for the driver, calls for the maids and asks them to clean up everything. He says, don't touch it, everything is so dirty. It's disgusting. Take all of the clothes and put it in a garbage bag and get rid of it. Get rid of it. So whilst he was instructing his maid and his driver on what to do, his little son comes running. His little son comes running into the room, rushes straight to the grandfather's plate, takes the plate and starts hugging the plate. The father, the young man, he sees what his son is doing and says, oh my son, leave that. It is a dirty plate. It is a plate that has not been washed for ages. It is a plate that is disgusting. Leave it. The son says, no dad, no, I want the plate. I want the plate. The father says, I said leave it. It is disgusting. It must be full of germs and bacteria. Leave the plate. The son says, no, I want the plate. Finally, the father says, okay, why do you want the plate so bad? The boy says, dad, when you grow old, I have to feed you with the same plate. Allahu Akbar. Actually, it is not a joke. What goes around comes around. You treat your parents bad, your children will treat you the same, my dear respected elders and brothers. Understand? We want our children to treat us well. Then it is upon us to respect our parents, to look after them well. What goes around comes around. If you treat your parents bad, no doubt your children will treat you bad or even worse than that. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all. Hadith is in Bukhari. A man goes to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he asks Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam permission to go for jihad. To go for jihad, Allahu Akbar, one of the greatest amal, jihad. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asks the man, Ahayyun walidak? Are your two parents living? The man replies in the affirmative. He says, yes. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam instructs the man, Fafihima fajahid. The same word, jihad, in other words, to strive. Then go and strive in regard to them. Help them be in their service. Allahu Akbar. Go and be in their service. That is better for you than jihad. Allahu Akbar. Scholars, our Salafun as-Salih, they go on to say, that from this narration, even permissible journeys, Say you're going on a trip. Say you're going on a vacation. Say you're going on a business trip. It is upon you to go to your parents and seek permission. Do you need me? Or can I go? If they say, no, we need you by our side, then it is upon us to stay by them. Allahu Akbar. If there is no permission for jihad, then what do you say about vacations and business trips and leisure trips? Allahu Akbar. This is what our Salafun al-Salih highlight from the hadith. Another narration, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said, رِضَى الرَّبِّ مِنْ رِضَى الْوَالِدِ, that the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is connected, closely connected to the pleasure of your father or your parent for that matter, your father or your mother. And also the displeasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is likewise connected to the displeasure of your father or your mother. Allahu Akbar. Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, he says that there are three things, there are three ayat which connect two things together, and these are all inseparable. Inseparable. For one to be accepted, the other has to also be in accordance with that, if not both. If one is not there, the other is not accepted. According to Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma, he says the three ayat, number one, وَأَطِيعُ اللَّهَ وَأَطِيعُ الرَّسُولِ, to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and obey Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If you only obey Allah and disobey Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then your obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is also not counted. You have to obey Allah and obey Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Both go hand in hand. Ayah number two, وَأَقِيمُ الصَّلَاةُ وَآتُ الزَّكَاةُ. You have to establish salah and you have to give out zakah. If you establish salah and do not give out zakah, your salah is also not accepted, according to Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhuma. The third ayah, أَنِشْكُرْ لِي وَلِوَالِدَيْكَ. Show gratitude unto me. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying this. Show gratitude unto me and show gratitude unto your parents. If you do not show gratitude unto your parents, you have not shown gratitude unto your maker, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, I leave you all with an incident that took place during the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is the narration which is recorded in Sahih Muslim. This is in regard to a special individual, just another few minutes. A special individual, an extremely special individual. And why was he given this status? It was for nothing other than his servitude to his mother. Umar radiallahu anhu, what a great sahabi radiallahu anhu. He had the habit, this was after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, whenever a delegation used to come from Yemen, he used to go to that delegation and ask them, Afikum Uwais ibn Amir? Afikum Uwais ibn Amir? Is Uwais ibn Amir with you? Is Uwais ibn Amir with you? He used to go and ask every delegation that came from Yemen, is Uwais ibn Amir with you? So many a time they used to say, no, no, no. Finally, one fine day, Uwais ibn Amir was in that particular group, the delegation that came, and they pointed out, yes, this is Uwais ibn Amir. Umar radiallahu anhu, Allahu Akbar, Amir al-Mu'mineen, he rushes to Uwais ibn Amir and he says, are you Uwais ibn Amir? He says, yes, I am. Are you Uwais ibn Amir, who is from Murad? It's a tribe, it's the name of a tribe. Are you Uwais ibn Amir from Murad, who is from Qaran? These are the two tribe names. He says, yes, I am. And are you the Uwais ibn Amir who has a mother who is blind? He says, yes, that is me. And then he goes on to ask him, are you Uwais ibn Amir who was afflicted with leprosy? And now you have got all that is remaining of it in the size of a dirham? He says, yes, that is I. I'm Uwais ibn Amir. Umar radiallahu anhu then says, سَمِعْتُ رَسُولَ اللَّهُ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ يَقُولُ. Allahu Akbar. He says, I heard Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the narrations go along the lines of these words, that you are the best of the tabi'een. He, Uwais ibn Amir, had never seen Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, he was from Yemen. Once ambassadors of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went to Yemen to call the people of Yemen to Islam, he was busy with his mother who was blind. He says that night, the night before the ambassadors came, the lights went off. In other words, we had no oil to light the candles. It was dark. And I could not find myself, in the sense, find my way in my home. But then I followed my blind mother. My mother, even though it was dark, because she was blind, she had got accustomed to how the layout of the house was. I followed her and made my way around the house. Allahu Akbar. Even though she was blind, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala showed her the way. The next day he goes and meets the ambassadors of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they were reciting the ayah, وَمَنْ لَمْ يَجْعَلِ اللَّهُ لَهُ نُورًا فَمَا لَهُ مِنْ نُورٍ. Allahu Akbar. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if he does not give nur, light for someone, then there is no light at all. The minute he heard that ayah, he embraced Islam. But he could not go and meet Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, even though Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was alive, because he was in the service of his mother. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in Medina, he talks about Uwais ibn Amir. He tells the sahaba ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhi majma, if you ever meet Uwais ibn Amir, he is a man who is from Murad, who is from Qaran, from the tribe Qaran, Uwais al-Qarani. If you meet him, see, he has been afflicted with leprosy and all he has got is a mark of a dirham on his shoulder. If you meet him, ask him to seek forgiveness for you. Allahu Akbar. For if he seeks forgiveness for you, it will be accepted. He was an individual, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. His dua was always accepted. His dua was always accepted. Umar radiallahu anhu, this was the reason why he rushed to meet Uwais ibn Amir. And he begged Uwais ibn Amir, seek, in other words, ask forgiveness for me. This is one of the permissible forms of tawassul. Ask forgiveness for me. Ask forgiveness for me. And Uwais ibn Amir, he seeks forgiveness on behalf of Umar radiallahu anhu, according to the instructions of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, this status was given to Uwais ibn Amir, who never even saw Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because he did not see Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he is not from the Sahaba. But yet, he was given such a great status, the reason being, he was in the servitude of his mother. Of his mother. Of his blind mother. This is how important it is for us to be good unto our parents. And like I said in the beginning, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, go to your parents and patch up things if things have gone sour with them before it's too late. Before it's too late. None of us has a guarantee that we will live for until this date or until that date. We do not know whether we may go first or our parents might pass away first. It is upon us to rush to them, to beg for their forgiveness and do whatever it takes to see that smile on their faces, because they are the greatest dose for us to enter Jannah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive all of our sins. And may He forgive the sins of our parents. And may He accept all of our good deeds. And may He unite all of us.